Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with our outstanding producer, Mr. Aaron Zommers, on the board, producing and engineering. Not only that, he has regular ears as well. It's 6 past the hour of 1 o'clock. Welcome into hour number two of the big program, Monday, March 18th, 2024. Many thanks to our sports reporter, Mike Clemens. Now, there's a guy. If you're going to have somebody report sports, not your casual fan, not somebody who's just sitting in a chair reading off the wire, but a guy who's there, who has real relationships with players, with coaches, who's a real insider, that's what you got with Mike Clemens.
It's not just somebody who's there, but somebody who you could not picture not being there.
Right. That's a perfect way to say it. You're absolutely right.
I also met him for the first time last week in person.
He's a great guy.
Absolutely.
He's passionate about athletics and about sports. He knows his stuff. He doesn't get too high, too low. He just tells you the information and gives you the inside information. That's what I love about it.
I heard him record some of his sportscast for the next day. And even though now I work in radio, it's still weird, like, and kind of cool, just the behind the scenes. You get to hear people, you know, how they do their different takes or whatever, or meeting people and seeing what they look like when you only heard their voice.
Right. I'm always a little like, people will meet me and they're like, oh, you're not how I thought you'd look. And I never know how to take that.
Do people say that?
Oh, not used to be when I worked at RCO. Sometimes I meet people and they'd say, I listen to you every week, but I haven't heard you. I've never seen you before. You're not, you, it's not the nice way to put it is you're not how I pictured you.
Right. Right.
But I think that, I mean, that's one of the things about radio is that if people don't watch on the stream, if they only listen to the audio, they develop in their mind what you look like. And then sometimes we look different. But anyway, can't change that.
Yeah.
We are who we are. But many thanks to Mike Clemens for being the fantastic dude that he is and joining us. We'll get him back in the program soon. Great time of year, March Madness. I love it. Good luck to the Wisconsin Badgers. Good luck to the Marquette Golden Eagles. May they meet in the Elite Eight. Are you going to fill out a bracket, Mr. Zommers? Are you a bracket kind of guy?
I'm not really a bracket kind of guy. I mean, I've never just been huge into sports, but it depends. If my roommates do it, I'll do it. Because, you know, hanging out with people's fun.
My quick knee jerk, I thought I should do this for the show today. And so I haven't really sat down and thought about it. But my really quick knee jerk Final Four, I've got Marquette from the South, Tennessee from the Midwest, Arizona from the West, and UConn, the defending national champion in the East. So UConn is the only one, the number one seed I got in the Final Four. Then I've got UConn versus Tennessee in the championship game, with UConn repeating. I just think UConn is a cut above everybody else.
See, I know nothing about any of the teams, so I'm basically just going to pick randomly if I fill one out.
I hope I'm hoping my Wisconsin Badgers could get all the way, of course, but I'm trying to be a little bit realistic. And I would love to see Marquette Wisconsin in the Elite Eight matchup. I mean, that would in Dallas, by the way, that would be phenomenal.
By the way, a comment from Jeff Perry on Facebook. You have the perfect look for radio.
Spoken like a fellow radio announcer.
That reminds me, in high school, somebody I was dating at the time once looked at me and said lovingly, like, you have a face for radio. And I was like, you do know that's an insult, right? And they were like, oh my God, no. I thought it was like a compliment. And I was like, no, you're saying that their face is ugly, so you should only hear their voice.
That's terrible.
And they felt really bad. I just thought it was funny because it was an accident.
Well, we will continue to follow the tournament. It gets underway on Thursday and Friday. The Marquette Golden Eagles play on Thursday. The Wisconsin Badgers play right here on the Civic Media Radio Network in selected stations. Hopefully one of yours is selected. Richland Center, Wisconsin Rapids, Amory, and Racine, Kenosha. Over the air, or you can listen on the Civic Media app. Download it on your Apple or Android device and listen to one of those fine stations for free. The Wisconsin Badgers taking on James Madison, not the constitutional person, but the
actual
school.
That'd be a pretty
school.
Easy game.
Yeah, it would be. But James Madison on around 8:30, 8:40, a late game on Friday night. So stay up and listen, cheer on the Badgers. Want to get back to the news of the day, and we don't often split things up and kind of come back to the same story, but we want to get Mike Clemens on there in hour number one because it is a big story of March Madness and those sports updates, but good to have a timeout from the hard news of the day. But I want to go back to this appearance that the former president, Donald Trump, made in Dayton, Ohio. I've been to Dayton, by the way, a lovely community there in Ohio. And Trump did this rally, this campaign speech, and the big headline of the day, and we discussed it in hour one, was that we played the cut in its entirety where Trump was talking about putting 100% tariffs on imported cars. And by the way, because of what he said next, that part, the 100% tariff, has been getting almost no play, which if you drive a car that's not built in the United States of America, or you buy cars that aren't vehicles that aren't built in the United States of America, which by the way are the majority, or many of them, you're going to pay astronomical prices. Because remember, when foreign tariffs are put on company products, it's not the manufacturer who ultimately pays that. That cost is passed on to the consumer, i.e. Americans. Can you imagine your car that my Dodge truck, most of it was built in Mexico. Many cars are built in Japan or other places. Can you imagine paying a 100% tariff on cars? That part alone is just goofy. So, but the next part, of course, then Trump went on to say that if he wasn't reelected, it would be a bloodbath. And Republicans like Scott Walker are trying to say, well, he meant, tariffs, cars. And as we talked in the first hour, Trygve Olson, who comes on this show every Wednesday, noon to one, as an expert in democracy, pointed out that the rhetoric alone is dangerous because Trump and Trumpism, by and large, has helped to divide us. That the majority of Americans and now the majority of Wisconsinites in their poll late last year at focus groups found that a majority of Wisconsinites view our political opponents as enemies, and that by Trump using terms like bloodbath, that only pours fuel on the fire. And we played the cut from Jen Psaki from MSNBC, in which she said, okay, you want to put it into context, and gave all these examples of Trump continually saying inflammatory things. And yesterday's comments of the bloodbath was just a long litany of one of them. What I found even more offensive, this is not getting a lot of play, but I wanted to play it for you. This was the way the whole thing started, with Donald Trump in a suit minus a tie and a red Make America Great Again cap, saluted during a weird rendition of the national anthem, and the way in which he was introduced. I'm going to play the cut for you. Then we're going to come back and talk about it. This was the intro over the weekend in Dayton, Ohio at the Trump rally.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the horribly and unfairly treated January 6th hostages.
That's all there is to that? All right. Well, I had another cut. I'll find it. Where it continues on, and right after that, like after the first stanza, Trump's voice saying the Pledge of Allegiance. So they literally broke up the Star Spangled, the National Anthem, with inserting Trump doing the Pledge of Allegiance. What's more bizarre about it is that rendition is sung by people in jail who were found guilty of crimes during January 6th. So insurrectionists, treasonous folks who are in jail, sang that song, sent it to Trump, apparently. Like, I don't know exactly how they do that, by the way. And then they insert Trump in the middle of it. And also, he's saluting, which you're only supposed to salute if you are in uniform, if you are a military person in uniform. Now, there are veterans who served admirably who will have their ball cap on that says from Vietnam or the Korean War, the Gulf War. Look, I'm never going to despair. Look, if you served in the military and you're a veteran and you want to wear that cap and you want to salute, God love you. I'm not going to say anything to that.
But if you got bone spurs.
But yes, but Trump never did serve in the military. And he's no longer the commander in chief. And also, a president does not salute during the Star Spangled Banner, the national anthem. They put their hand over their heart because our presidents don't wear military uniforms even when they're the commander in chief. That's like a dictatorship, right? So, our friend, Matt Flynn, fond of saying, not woke if you don't know history. So let's give you a little bit of history. This is from Bill Kristol, former Republican conservative columnist. He says this over the weekend of what you just heard. Bill Kristol says, the Horst, forgive my German, the Horst Wessellied, or other words, Horst Wessel song, was the anthem of the Nazi Party. And became, from 1933 to 1945, the co-national anthem of Nazi Germany. Wessel was the party's key martyr figure. From 1934 on, a regulation required the right arm be extended when it was sung. Kristol says, I know I should resist Nazi comparisons or allusions. I usually do. But the embrace of the January 6th insurrectionist drove me over the edge. And it is an embrace, not a minimization or a rationalization or a justification. An embrace by the nominee of one of the two major political parties. I mean, that is spooky. Come back, take your phone calls, and we're going to tie it back to an event in Wisconsin over the weekend. That's right, things are getting spooky in the 8th Congressional District up and around Green Bay. Come back, tell you about it after this. It's the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Ready Network. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. 20 now past the hour of 1 o'clock on Monday, March 18th. Zomer's on the board. Glad to be along with you. Give us a ring if you want to weigh in. 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. Talking more about this bizarre Trump rally over the weekend. We've talked a lot. Other people have talked about the bloodbath comments. And whether you want to say they were taken out of context or not, as the main important part here that Trygve Olson for the Lincoln Project, who knows about autocracies, who's fought for democracy around the world, said just the fact that Trump used the language of bloodbath is just another in a long litany of what authoritarians do, which is dividing people, ginning people up, and then, of course, making it sound like he is the only person who can stop it. I must be elected. Not somebody from our party, me. I'm the only person. It's a key sign of an authoritarian. Mr. Zomer is doing a great job on the board here. I think we found the other clip. So we played it for, I don't want to give him credit. I don't want to do the whole thing. But I want you to hear this part. So Trump has been announced that they want people to stand to the, you know, the unfair hostages, as they call them, the January 6th people who've been convicted of crimes in jail, singing the national anthem. And I want you to pick up now in the national anthem and then hear what comes next. Here it is from Dayton over the weekend. Oh, say can you see, I will not.
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
So, I mean, just hear how spooky that is and how weird. I mean, the national anthem, in my opinion, when it's performed, it should be done in a reverent way, because really it's a tribute to all those who have come before us, all those who have given their lives so that we might enjoy our freedom. And for a presidential candidate, a former president, to have this plane, number one, you're having prisoners who have been convicted of crimes, who you're calling hostages, sing it. And then you interrupt the song for, I was going to use the word Fuhrer, but I mean the guy who says, I'm the only one who can save you, to do the Pledge of Allegiance. I mean, just listen to the way they mixed that. I mean, it sounds right out of a dictatorship.
Yes, and extremely ominous.
Yes, like, exactly.
Normally, when you have the Star-Spangled Banner, it's patriotic. You know, it is reverent. It right. has to pay respects to the people who we've lost, but it's not... Like, this sounds like a horror movie version. Like, next we're going to hear one of, like, a children's choir singing it slightly off key with tinkly piano in the background to really freak you out.
No, that's a really good way to put it. I mean, think of Whitney Houston singing the star. I mean, I'm not sure anybody's ever sung them better.
I don't think so.
It's uplifting. It makes goosebumps. It makes the hair rise in your neck. It makes you proud to be an American. I mean, that's what the Star Spangled Banner should do.
This unnerves me.
Exactly. And you're right. It's ominous. It's dark. It's negative, which again, if you listen to a lot of the speech from over the weekend, it was very dark, very ominous, very negative. Well, let me help you put this together and connect the dots, because it wasn't just weird stuff going on in Ohio over the weekend. Over the weekend, OC, Eric Coveney, stands for Orange County Eric Coveney, the Republican Senate candidate running against incumbent Democratic Senator Tammy Baldwin, Eric Coveney appeared with a January 6th convict who admitted he illegally entered Capitol grounds and shouted, "Take it," to a group of J6 rioters trying to steal a shield from a police officer. This is the tweet from the Brown County. Brown County is where Green Bay is located. The Brown County GOP says, thanks to Lee Zeldin, Brandon Straka, Alex Bruzewitz for headlining our Lincoln Reagan Day dinner in Brown County. We were joined by U.S. Senate candidate Eric Coveney and two declared District 8 U.S. Congress candidates, Roth for Wisconsin and Senator Andre Jacques. Thanks, sponsors, for a special night. So the Brown County Republican Party confirmed that this guy, this insurrectionist, Lee Zeldin, was there, along with Eric Coveney and Alec Bruzewitz. He's the Trumpster from Florida trying to come back to Wisconsin and run for the 8th Congressional District, along with Roth and Jacques. So here's a great story we're going to get into from Mother Jones on this Lee Zeldin guy. Headline from Mother Jones: from hairstylist to January 6th influencer, meet the man helping the GOP whitewash the insurrection. You don't hear a lot about this guy, but he's a dangerous figure. Brandon Straka. Before we do that, we're going to go to the phone lines, 855-752-4842. Go up to Eau Claire. Gene, listening up at CFW, the Tap in Eau Claire. Gene, thanks for calling. We'll see you.
Thank you so much for covering all this information. People need to wake up, because this is dangerous. I couldn't believe it when I heard it, and then I saw it, and I thought, oh, my God, this is worse yet. And you're praising the people that committed crimes on behalf of the criminal leaders standing up there. It's unfathomable. So I hope people wake up and it's gross. It makes you sick. It's hard to sleep. but we need to accept that this is the way it is and fight back. So thank you for, I'm going to go right away so you can give us some more information on what's going on in our state. Thank you.
Hey, Jean, always appreciate the call. Appreciate your listenership. Appreciate all those folks up there, the great Chippewa Valley listening on WCFW, the TAP up there in Chippewa Valley and Chippewa Falls and Eau Claire. Off the text line, Jeff from Shorewood, listening on WAUK, the Shaw, down in Waukesha, says, ominous and dark with more than a hint of irony. He, meaning Trump, pledges allegiance to a flag. As a veteran with a service-connected disability, I'm blank appalled. I'm effing appalled. We'll simply leave it at that. And I think Jeff makes a great point. If you look at what Trump has said, he's called those who died, our service men and women who died, called them suckers and losers, has said that he doesn't want to appear with disabled veterans. If you look at how he's treated and what he has said about the brave men and women who have served this country, it's appalling. And then you add this in. Again, this ominous, dark rendition, interrupting the national anthem for Trump to give a weird rendition of a Pledge of Allegiance. I agree with Jeff. I'm not a veteran, but I have great reverence for all those who served. And I can only imagine that if you were a veteran who wore the uniform, who had the flag of this country, who fought for our freedoms, and then to have that that happened in Ohio over the weekend as your commander in chief. I mean, it has to be appalling. We're going to come back and break this down, what happened in Green Bay over the weekend and why this is dangerous to Wisconsin. Don't miss it. Your news starts now on the Civic Media Radio Network. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. 34 minutes now past the hour of 1 o'clock on this Monday, March 18th, 2024. Mr. Zommer's on the board. Glad to have you along. Going back and kind of breaking down these events over the weekend, particularly this disturbing rally by Trump in Dayton, Ohio. And a lot of the focus has been on the quote where he used the term bloodbath. It'd be a bloodbath if he wasn't going to be elected. And we've already played that cut in its entirety because Republicans, MAGA Republican folks are saying, well, you're taking that out of context. He was talking about, having 100% tariffs on cars. And if he wasn't elected, that it was going to be a bloodbath in terms of cars and the economy. But Trigvi Olson, our friend from the Lincoln Project, rebutted that in a great story, in Raw Story, said it doesn't really matter the context. It's the fact that he keeps using this rhetoric like bloodbath that revs people up. And again, the research from the Lincoln Project has shown that in the United States of America and in Wisconsin, now over half of people consider their political opponents their enemy. And that Trump's language is intentional. It's meant to scare you. It's meant to rev you up. Meant to bring fear. And of course, he follows that with, I'm the only one who can stop it. And if you get rid of the theatrics for a moment, and you talk to somebody like Trigvi Olson, who has worked on democracy around the world, this is all intentional. It is quintessential. Autocrats, an autocracy, dictators. It's how they work the mind. All right? Dictators work as much in the mind as they do physically to intimidate people. And so this is all meant for the MAGA Republicans, the base of the Republican Party, what Donald Trump and Don Jr. now says is 96 to 100% of the Republican Party, the MAGAs. They've taken over the Republican National Committee, the party, literally. They're now in control of the money, which I'm assuming, you know, if it's anything like the Trump companies, are going to be broke soon, which is fine with me. Donald Trump has taken over the Republican Party. And who's standing up to him? Very few people. We're going to get into what happened in Green Bay here in a second. But before we do, I want to play this. This is another cut from over the weekend in Dayton, Ohio. Had to edit it for FCC compliancy. Donald Trump bemoaning other Republicans. Here's Trump from over the weekend.
And I obliterate my competition, you know. And they said, sir, please, don't talk about these people that way. They're Republicans. I said, I don't give a shit. They're terrible. I said, I don't care. No, my highly paid advisors, sir, you shouldn't talk to them about that.
So once again, Donald Trump reminding you that if you are a Republican and you vote for your local sheriff or county clerk or your local state representative and you think they're a great person, but let's say you're more of a Mitt Romney Republican. Let's say you're a Paul Ryan Republican. Let's say you're a Tommy Thompson Republican or a Nikki Haley Republican. Donald Trump literally doesn't give a blank about you. Saying it right out loud. There is no room for moderation. His own vice president, Mike Pence, came out this week, late last week, over the weekend, said it again and faced the nation, making it clear. Mike Pence says he will not endorse Donald Trump for another term. When your own vice president, who saw you more than anyone else, says, no, the guy who I served with is not good for the country for another 4 years, you might have a problem. So I just ask people to think, because I think people can think for themselves. You don't need me telling you how to vote. But listen to these cuts we play. Listen to how Donald Trump bastardizes the national anthem. How he says he's the only one who can fix it. Did you ever hear Tommy Thompson run around the state and say, ladies and gentlemen, all these problems, you know, Tommy Thompson is the only one that can fix them? No, you never heard that. Tommy Thompson go around the state and he says, ladies and gentlemen, Wisconsin's the heroes. All of us in our community, our great business leader, our great teachers, our great farmers, our great ag producers. I was talking to somebody earlier. Great. I mean, this is how Tommy, remember these were the days of it used. This is what it used to be like to be a Republican politician in Wisconsin. Tommy Thompson had all these great stories. He'd get up on the stump and he'd say, ladies and gentlemen, Wisconsin's the kind of place where you take a vacation and you come home and your neighbors mowed the yard for you and they come out of their house with a pack of Miller Lite in one hand and a bag of cheese curds in the other and say, welcome home, friend. He used to say that. And the thing is, it's based in the truth. And he was a cheerleader for Wisconsin. You uplift people. You make them feel better. Tommy Thompson used to say about Democrats, he'd say, isn't it great to be a Republican, ladies and gentlemen? I hate to be a Democrat. They get up and suck prunes and drink grapefruit every day. That's why they look so sour. And they got a big laugh, of course, you know. But now it's just the reverse. Joe Biden's uplifting. He's positive. Donald Trump is sour, is fearful, is angry. Ask yourself, if you vote Republican, which one exemplifies the true meaning of conservatism and being a Republican? It ain't Donald Trump. 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. Jack from Merrimack. Jack, thanks for calling in. What say you?
Well, thanks for taking my call. Here's a little list I picked off the internet. It has an authoritarian leader who claims the government's a disaster and I alone can fix it. Tears down democratic institutions, elections, courts, law enforcement. Takes retribution upon political competitors, declares their enemies of the state, seeks to silence political competitors by control of the media, even calling legitimate media enemies of the state, claims to be a populist that works to destroy unions, workers' rights, and human rights in general, rewrites history with their own alternative facts instead of what really happened, censored books, education, removes inconvenient facts and ideas, persecutes vulnerable social and or ethnic groups, creates as much chaos as possible, from useless legislation to blaming other groups for national problems to engaging in threats of war, and in order to distract from authoritarian policies and actions. This is a listing that I got on the characteristics of fascism. Yeah. Does this sound like a current political party that we know?
Rings a lot of bells, doesn't it, Jack?
Yeah. This is really bad. I sent this via text, but I don't know if anybody got a chance to read it. But I remember, I'm a really old guy, and I remember McCarthyism.
Sure.
And, I mean, I'm really old. I remember McCarthyism, and I'm wondering, where is Joe McCarthy and the House Un-American Activities Committee when you really need them?
Right.
Yeah, that's sarcasm.
Right. No, I think you're right, Jack. And this is the part where I yes, it makes me angry, but rather than, you know, getting my undies in a bundy here and just yelling about it, I think it's important that we, what you just did, just lay out the facts, right? I think the majority of voters are smart enough to think for themselves. Yes, there's 30% that are going to do whatever Trump wants. But I think that the rest of folks, if given the opportunity for the real facts, if you look at history, if you look at what's going on, if you look at the things like you just read, it's pretty clear. And I think that people can look at this and say, look, I might not agree with all the policies of Joe Biden, but we have to come together as a coalition. Former Republicans, current disaffected Republicans, Democrats, liberals, progressives alike, at this one time, because if we don't preserve democracy, a representative democracy, then nothing else matters.
Yeah, Trump said something like, if Joe Biden gets elected, we're not going to see another Democratic election in this country. Which reminds me of the old quote from Joseph Goebbels, who is Hitler's minister of propaganda, which has accused the other side of that of which you are guilty.
Yeah. Well said.
And that sort of says it all.
Well said. Thanks, Jack. Really appreciate the call. Jack and Merrimack, if you want to join in, 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. You can also text us on the Civic Media app. So want to report or want to give you the information here. Again, over the weekend, OC Orange County Eric Hovde appeared with January 6th convict who admitted he illegally entered the Capitol grounds and shouted, "Take it," to a group of January 6th rioters trying to steal a shield from a police officer. Up in Brown County, Green Bay, this guy was with Eric Hovde and a bunch of other Republicans at their annual Lincoln-Reagan Day dinner. Well, I think both of those people would roll over in their graves if they knew what was happening, by the way. So this guy, Brandon Straka, great article. Go to motherjones.com. Motherjones.com says, from hairstylist to January 6th influencer, meet the man helping the Republican Party to whitewash the insurrection. It's a long feature article. Not going to read you the entire thing, but I want to lift up a couple of things. It starts out, quote, at the New Hampshire GOP Leadership Summit in October, former presidential hopeful Vivek Ramaswamy made a bold promise. If elected, he would pardon participants in the January 6th riot at the U.S. Capitol, who he claimed were, quote, targets of politicized federal prosecutions, unquote. The pledge came in response to a question from an audience member with some skin in the game. Conservative influencer Brandon Straka. In September 2021, Straka pleaded guilty to one misdemeanor count of engaging in disorderly and disruptive conduct after being part of the mob of rioters outside the Capitol. Despite claiming that he did nothing wrong, Straka has been spinning that version of history ever since he left home, home detention, that is, in early 2022. His social media feeds and public appearances, like the one in New Hampshire, brim with commentary alleging his prosecution was a part of a liberal conspiracy designed to silence him. He claims he was forced to plead guilty because he couldn't get a fair trial in D.C., which, of course, was not true. But there is a voluminous record, including court records, his own texts, and depositions obtained by the House January 6th committee, and his own copious social media posts and videos he streamed that tell a very different story from the one Straka now tells publicly. While it's true he didn't commit any violence on January 6th, Straka wasn't exactly a neutral bystander. He'd been an underappreciated player in the Stop the Steal movement that sought to overturn the 2020 election results and helped lay the groundwork for the insurrection. As a part of his plea agreement, Straka admitted under oath that when he entered the Capitol grounds on January 6th, he knew he was doing so illegally. Let me say that again. Straka said under oath that he knew what he was doing was illegal. He also admitted he'd gone there with the intent to impede, disrupt, or disturb the orderly conduct of the session of Congress. Once on the Capitol grounds, according to his plea agreement, Straka yelled, quote, "Go, go, go," unquote, to encourage other protesters to go inside the Capitol while police tried to hold them back. More after this. Don't go anywhere. We'll continue this story. We'll wrap it up. Take your phone calls as well. It's the All Ball Show for a Monday on the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the All Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 10 before the hour of 2 o'clock. At the top of the hour, a little news, weather, sports, and then Maggie Dawn takes over these airwaves with the Maggie Dawn Show every afternoon, Monday through Friday, from 2 until 4. The Maggie Dawn Show. Do not miss it. Talking about what happened over the weekend, kind of digging deeper, if you will, not just in Dayton, Ohio with Trump, which was, of course, terrible. There's a lot more cuts we could play for you. But I think it's important to kind of bring this back and show how it's important in Wisconsin. And in Green Bay or Brown County over the weekend, Orange County, Eric Covey, running against Tammy Baldwin for the U.S. Senate, appeared with this guy, Straka, who you probably haven't heard a lot about, an insurrectionist who has pleaded guilty, said under oath that what he knew that what he was doing was illegal, said that he yelled, go, 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 to encourage other protesters to go inside the Capitol on January 6th while police tried to hold them back. He also, according to this story in Mother Jones, he also admitted to chiming in with the crowd, yelling, quote, take it, unquote, to a group of rioters as they seized a shield from a Capitol police officer. Now, this guy Straka took a bunch of video of this, put it online, tries to tie it with, you know, he calls it the liberal deep state, which is completely ridiculous. Now, according to Mother Jones, Straka's views are not unusual among January 6th defendants. In a report published in September of 2022, the Chicago Project on Scrutiny and Threats found that very few people prosecuted for J6 crimes have rejected the anti-democratic goals of the attack on Congress. Of the 217 defendants in the study who'd be sentenced by mid-July of 2022, only 48 of 217 had repudiated the political goals of the riot. Of those, only 10 admitted that the 2020 election was not stolen. So Straka is a stark example of why, despite the prosecution of more than 1,200 riot participants, the number of Republicans who believe the events of January 6th constituted serious political violence designed to overturn a legitimate election has fallen sharply over the past 2 years. Goes along with what Trygve Olson said. We read that earlier on this show. Let's go to the phone lines, 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. Joe in Madison. Joe, always a pleasure. Thanks for listening. What have you got for us today, Joe?
It's disheartening, you know, to hear that after all of this time, after all of this information that's out, after, what, 60-plus court cases, that there are still people who believe that the election was stolen. You had your chance to prove that you think that it was stolen through all of those court cases, and none of them came to the fruition to support your point of view. Perhaps your point of view was wrong. You know, at what point do you just say your hallucinations are not my business? What the court's view is my business. I find it fascinating that people describing themselves ordinarily as the Back the Blue folks would be so happy to hear that a Capitol Police officer had their shield seized. I imagine the terror that that person felt when the crowd was moving in on them and they'd lost one method of defense that they had, and people were cheerfully screaming and yelling for him to be left vulnerable. Boy, that's pretty bad. There's no way to describe it. And I think we use these simple terms like the January 6th protesters but you know, it's really time to call it what it is. They're an insurrectionist doesn't really seem to get at it. They're criminals. It's criminal to say that you are going to impede my vote. Who are you? You know, a guy from Green Bay says that my vote doesn't count and I want the whole election upended because I just feel that the election was stolen. I'm sorry. You know, you're nuts, number one. And number two, you're a criminal who's seeking to steal my vote. That's what it is. You can describe it as political action or whatever, but it is all about stealing somebody else's vote. And there's nothing more elemental in our democracy as that. So I really think we need to up the language a little bit more to describe this. If after all of what's transpired and to see people just flocking around this common criminal of Trump, who basically is a mafioso guy, he's on the same level as the mob. We know that. That's how he operates. So for those criminals who choose, and you know, I'm sorry, it wasn't just a misman. You are a criminal, and you chose to try to steal my vote, and you chose to try to leave those cops in an incredibly vulnerable position. It's not right. That's not nonviolent demonstration. That's not, you know, what the civil rights people did. This is it's stealing. That's right. What it is stealing. Thanks a lot. I appreciate the chance to talk.
Appreciate you, Joe. Thank you very much for calling in. And you're right. I mean, we have to call it out. And Joe is absolutely right. You know, Republicans love to the line about Back the Blue. But yet Eric Hovde and other Republicans were in Green Bay and listened to this guy, Brandon Straka, a keynote speaker, who pled guilty to January 6th crimes. And he says this in the MotherJones.com story. He says this, quote, "I meant the words I said at my sentencing, but I am not sorry for an insurrection I did not participate in," unquote. Not sorry for an insurrection. 855-752-4842. Andrew from Waukesha, you have the last word. A minute and a half left. It is yours. Andrew, what do you have to say?
Thanks for taking my call. So I really wish there was a more honest debate about this topic. I mean, I realize you're going to hammer on this word insurrection, you know, forever and ever, but quite frankly, an insurrection has to have the possibility of sustaining more than one day. You've never explained how they were actually going to hold the Capitol, as if the National Guard or the Pentagon would not immediately react to a bunch of people trying to quote unquote seize power from the United States government. So, okay, whatever. The first insurrection in history that would have been successful without actually having any arms or any plan for day two. But let's talk about the election stuff too. There have never been claims of election fraud beyond just people's opinions that they don't trust it. That's all.
Donald Trump says it was rigged. Donald Trump says it was stolen. The Republican
that's
nominee.
His opinion. That, yeah, exactly. That's his opinion. See, this is the thing we don't discuss.
He's the standard bearer.
We cannot prove our system is not designed to prove or disprove voter fraud. It is
all right, Andrew, thanks a lot. Really appreciate the call. So here's the deal quickly. On January 6th, the whole deal was to stall it so it could go to the Supreme Court so that they could overturn the election. And thanks to Mike Pence and Democrats in Congress, that didn't happen, and democracy lives on. We'll come back tomorrow. Stay tuned for Maggie Dawn. Your news is next. Keep banging your drum.